Mobile Suit Gundam had been around for 10 long years, with 3 full-length TV anime, a feature-length movie, and an OVA with tons of home video sales. Not to mention the world of Gunpla, which is responsible for bringing the mecha series off of life support in the first place. Plastic models really caught on in the early 80s, and the heat never really died down. Due to this popularity, Gundam animations came out every few years, and while all of them have their merits, it's understandable that the team behind some of the best mecha anime of all time would want to try and expand that universe and try something new. Plans came together for a new, full-length anime series. A team was formed and helmed by the series creator Yoshiyuki Tomino himself. It seems that some sort of production issues plagued the show, and there was some sort of disagreement among the internal production staff. 13 episodes of the show were already written, with the rest of the series still in planning when the show was unceremoniously canceled. However, Sunrise is never one to let a sleeping dog lie, and decided that the 13 episodes would be cobbled together into a theatrical film, with the rest of the story sort of also being adapted as well. Unfortunately, it's pretty hard to find information on how much of the original script was adapted into the final product, so I can only guess at what the original story would have been. What fans were left with was Mobile Suit Gundam F91, a 2-hour feature-length film that has a plotline that is crammed full of concepts that never really pan out, and is somewhat confusing due to its weird pacing issues. The story behind F91 is almost as interesting as the movie itself. It's always fun and interesting to me personally to look at pieces of animation that came out despite any hardships that they may have gone through. Gundam in particular has always had issues, but usually they were able to pull off something great. With F91, Sunrise produced more of a middling result, though one that has a lot of interesting ideas, mech designs, beautiful animation, and some absolutely great action. So without further distraction, let's strap in for 1991's Mobile Suit Gundam F91. The movie opens with the unfortunately familiar sight of mobile suits busting through the hatch of a space colony. Our first shots of the new mobile suit designs in F91 is an ominous one, as we get a look at them shrouded in the shadows of the entry hatch. We cut away to the inside of the colony, and as always, it's a pretty idyllic view with blue skies, greenery, and the citizens in the midst of a festival. Gundam F91 takes place in the Universal Century Year 123, about as far removed as we've seen so far for the Gundam timeline. In the 40 or so years since the One-Year War, the colonies of Side 4 have reorganized and become known as the Frontier Colonies. It's here on Frontier 4 that we meet our main character and legally required Gundam boy Seabook Arno. Seabook and his friend Cecily Fairchild are attending a festival where he goads her into taking part in some sort of beauty pageant. It is unfortunately cut short as the mobile suits from the first scene begin fighting within the colony. These mechs belong to a group known as the Crossbone Vanguard. Initially just described as rebels, pirates, or a militia, they're rebelling against the Federation government and attempting to establish a space aristocracy called Cosmo Babylonia, based in Side 4. No matter the context of their actions, the Crossbone Vanguard cause a ton of destruction and mayhem within the colony. Civilians are caught in the crossfire trying to flee from the warring factions. We do get this really famous scene of a mother running and being smacked on the head by a huge shell casing, and then dying from the trauma. It really sets the tone for the rest of the opening scenes, and it also serves as a really good sense of scale for the mobile suits and their weaponry. Seabook and Cecily pick up a ragtag group of other students and citizens on the way to one of the colony's emergency shelters located in an old war museum. It's here we get a pretty cool glance at an old Zaku in the background. And that's pretty much the only callback to Zeon that we get in F91. This is the first time it really feels like they want to move past that conflict. and as such, many events from older Gundam media aren't even mentioned. Unfortunately for our group of ragtag survivors, this crazy old dude blasts through the museum doors in an old tank. He tries to defend the museum, but is incredibly unsuccessful, getting one of the group killed in the process. We get a moment here with Seabook trying to get Arthur to wake up after his body crumples to the bottom of a wall. It's quite a realistic depiction of violence, which is something I've come to expect from Gundam by now. He also destroys the entrance to the shelter in the chaos, which was just about the worst thing that could have happened. The remaining members of the group steal the tank in order to try and make it across the colony to another shelter, where they can board an escape pod and leave the colony. They actually run into some Federation military guys on the way, and let's just say they aren't super helpful. Even 40 years later, the Feddies are still giant assholes. In fact, this guy literally says, "Let's use the children as human shields." You can't get much more on the nose than that. The group runs from the Federation soldiers, realizing that they're going to be even less help than they thought. While fleeing, they run into Seabook's dad, who defends his son's group by shooting a dude in the face with a welding torch. It's pretty badass, all things considered. It is revealed that the Crossbone Vanguard is hunting for Cecily, and while the group of survivors is making their way to an escape pod, she's accosted by her own father, Theo Fairchild. It's here where Gundam F91 takes its first sharp turn with the plot. Cecily is revealed to actually be Bera Rona, the heir to the Rona family, a group of aristocrats that run the Crossbone Vanguard. A pilot named Doral reveals himself to be Cecily's half-brother, and both him and Theo convince her to leave with them. They then go to meet her father, Carrazzo Rona, better known as Iron Mask. All of this is introduced incredibly quickly, and it doesn't help alleviating any of the confusion caused by the extreme pacing. We went from 25 minutes of a thrilling colony invasion and escape to a reveal of a secret identity. And now we're learning that Cecily's mother ran away with Theo, leaving Carrazzo and taking Cecily with her as a child. Carrazzo's reaction to being cuckolded is to go completely insane and don a big iron helmet, and I have to say they try to make him really intimidating, but I just think he's kinda lame. His design is alright, though sometimes it looks like he has a giant ass neck. He just goes on about how his mask keeps his emotions in check and keeps the beast inside. And he has a line where he's like, "If it weren't for this iron mask, I would beat you to death." It's just very silly, and it's not subtle at all. Making the attempt to create an intimidating Darth Vader-esque villain fall sort of flat. He gets even sillier later once his ultimate plan is revealed, but we'll get to that. Anyway, Theo Fairchild, who's been acting as Cecily's adopted father, has decided to sell her out to get close to the Rona family. Why he thinks a man who went crazy enough to never show his face in public after being cucked by a bread maker would be cool with him now is beyond me. While this conversation is happening, we are presented with the reason that Theo would want to get close to the Ronas in the first place. For one, they have a ton of money and power, as illustrated by their clothing and lavish estates, as well as the fact that they can fund a private military that has enough power to bully the Federation around. Their ultimate plan is revealed to be the founding of a space kingdom called Cosmo Babylonia. Led by a noble ruling class, they would found their kingdom starting with Colony Frontier 4, renaming it to Cosmo Babylon, putting them in a similar situation to Zeon prior to the One-Year War. That was a ton of info, and believe me, it's kinda hard to follow while watching at the pace of the movie. I perused the Gundam Wiki quite a lot while taking notes for this one. This is the first time that you can really feel the fact that this is a 50-episode show compressed into a 2-hour movie. This revelation with Cecily feels like we're seeing something 10 episodes in. I feel like I barely know her, other than the fact that she's Seabook's friend and maybe potential love interest. She's spent all her time running, and now we find out that she's a princess? Okay, cool. Cecily meets her grandfather, Meitzer Rona, backer of the Crossbone Vanguard and leader of the newly founded Cosmo Babylon. Another revelation comes as Meitzer wants Cecily to be the queen of his new government. Having a charismatic young face as the figurehead of your new space kingdom probably helps. While all this is happening, the group of survivors have escaped Frontier 4 aboard a lifeboat, and there's this really brutal scene where they're flying past the colony in space and all this debris is just spilling out. There's trees, vehicles, chunks of building, animals, and a lot of these things are only on screen for a few frames. During the escape, Seabook's dad was left behind as he went to go and save a little girl. I will also mention here that Seabook's mom is mentioned as some sort of scientist that left home to work on the moon before the events of the movie. The escape pod arrives at the sister colony of Frontier 1 and meets up with a Federation training ship called the Space Ark. We learn that the ship's crew is mostly made up of trainees and civilians, as the actual crew was killed off in the earlier attack. Even Captain Lolly is only a junior officer, taking over as acting captain in the chaos. This setup is extremely similar to the White Base in the original series, a crew of trainees and civilians forced to crew a warship that just happens to be carrying an experimental mobile suit. The F91 itself actually has a pretty cool design, being lighter and more compact than some of the later mechs like the New Gundam and Sazabi. In fact, the F91 stands 3 meters shorter than the original RX-78 Gundam. The mobile suits in F91 are smaller than other series as a general rule. In universe, these new model mobile suits are much more agile and with higher maneuverability when compared to a suit like the Jegan. The reason for this is that beam weaponry has far outpaced armor, and it was actually more efficient to make smaller mechs as time and technology progressed. What's the point in having a ton of armor on a 20 meter high mobile suit if a single shot is enough to take it out anyway? I personally think that this explanation is pretty smart and it does make sense. I mean, technology does tend to become more compact as time goes on, and Gundam has no shortage of one-hit kills on machines that I would assume are very expensive. However, fans to this day bring this up as a point of contention for the series. Some just like the larger machines because huge robots are cool, and I have to agree with that. I mean, in War in the Pocket, some of my favorite stuff was the sense of scale with the Zaku and GMs battling amongst buildings and parks. There was, however, another reason for scaling down the suits in F91. With models like the New Gundam being quite large, it was becoming more and more expensive for the Gunpla manufacturers to produce parts, which in turn was driving up the cost of the models in stores. The economy of Japan in the 90s was on a downturn, and the average person had less expendable income as a result. So in a bid to reduce cost on producing models, Sunrise told the animation team to scale the sizes down. A lot of people just don't like business decisions like this influencing things within an established series lore, and I can certainly understand that perspective. Just look at 2020's gaming landscape to see how business meddling in art usually has less than amazing results.
I am not overconfident. I'm just better than everyone else.
And in a cruel twist of fate for Bandai, this ploy to drive down costs not only didn't work, it actually had the opposite effect. The companies that produced the pieces for the model kits didn't have access to any molds that would fit the scale of kits like the Gundam F91, and they'd have to create brand new ones from scratch. With older kits, they could at least reference older pieces and repurpose older molds, but here they just had nothing. By the time that Mobile Fighter G Gundam would release in 1994, the mechs would return to the 18 to 20 meter range anyway. On the design side of things, I really love the look of the mobile suits in F91. The titular suit itself looks incredible. I just really love its design. It shares the split V fin and the rounded legs with my all-time favorite mech design, the New Gundam. Whereas the New Gundam still has that blocky upper half and the huge funnels, the F91 has a much more rounded and sleek look. The fact that it looks so aerodynamic definitely helps sell the fact that the suits in this movie can fly in atmosphere without transforming or using any sort of vehicle. The Crossbone Vanguard suits also look amazing. This might be an unpopular opinion, but I think they look like a good alternative Zaku type of villainous grunt suit. The Danann Gay in particular, I think, is a design that looks as good as some things we saw in Zeta. I love the weird rabbit ears and the asymmetrical shoulder pieces, and they definitely took that World War II Nazi soldier look to the next level, making it immediately sinister and threatening. These designs just work incredibly well within the universe of the film. The F91 itself has a biocomputer designed by none other than Seabook's mom. This is something similar to the Psycomu in Zeta and the Psychoframe in Char's Counterattack, and it's sort of a tool for some new type shit later on. Speaking of new types, in the time that's passed since the second Neo Zeon War of Char's Counterattack, new type philosophy has pretty much fallen completely by the wayside. Seabook is told that if he can pilot the F91, well, he might be a new type, and when he asks what a new type even is, they just kind of tell him it's someone born with natural piloting ability. Sort of similar to how Jedi were basically forgotten by the time that A New Hope started. And this isn't the only similarity to Star Wars, but I'll get more into that in a bit. This is where the movie's pacing became confusing to me, and I'm a person who takes pages of notes on these movies and shows, so I was paying really good attention, believe me. I would never look down on someone for saying that F91 confused them, because there's a lot of jumping around between different groups of characters and skipping events here and there, so the movie isn't 18 hours long. Arno decides to pilot the F91 in order to protect the space arc and his friends. He ends up sortieing, and he's actually not too bad, getting a double kill against some CV mobile suits. Unfortunately, this causes him to have a small freakout when he has to realize the horrors of war firsthand. We then jump cut back to Frontier 4 with Seabook at Theo's closed down bakery. Talk about whiplash, I mean it goes right from Seabook having a mental break to him just standing there. It's not until later that we find out that he apparently stole the F91 and came back to Frontier 4 to try and find Cecily, but we aren't shown or even told this until later on. Some information that Seabook finds here is that Theo has closed his bakery and moved near the mansion the Ronas are currently occupying in an attempt to cozy up to them. Kind of a ballsy move to get all buddy-buddy with the dude whose wife you stole, but okay. Seabook sneaks off to the Rona mansion after hearing that Cecily is the daughter of the Rona family. We see Cecily cut her hair in an apparent attempt to come to terms with her new life as a royal. Seabook is able to make contact with her and asks her to escape with him, but she tells him it's just too late for her and he's discovered by the estate's guards. We then cut to a speech where Carrazzo is talking about rebuilding the colony and the strength of Cosmo Babylon when an unseen assailant attempts to assassinate him. Unfortunately, whoever decided to try and kill Iron Mask shot him in the only part of his body that they know is made of metal, not the sharpest tool in the shed. I will say if there's a moment in this movie that does make Carrazzo seem badass, it's this one right here.
To forever protect the entire Earth sphere. To those of you who disagree with us, I say to you, come and try to kill me. I will not run away or hide.
That's telling them I am not.
Seabook gets spotted in the crowd and chased, only being saved by the sudden reappearance of his father. Unfortunately, during the escape, Mr. Arno is injured and he dies upon arrival at Frontier 1. This whole section, from the first time that Seabook sorties in the F91 to the assassination attempt and subsequent escape, takes place over about 7 minutes. It's very fast, to say the least, and if you aren't paying complete attention, I could see just being totally lost. We then get a scene with Cecily's mom, Nadia, showing up and wanting to talk to Carrazzo. Cecily seems pretty resigned to her fate at this point, and has been taking up the mantle of future queen. Theo also just straight up gets killed by Carrazzo in this scene. We don't know how he does it, but he just drops dead and it's actually sort of funny. Cecily isn't dissuaded by her mother's words and even begins training to pilot a mobile suit. Back at the space arc, the crew finds itself under attack by the Crossbone Vanguard, with Seabook's friends wanting to desert, even though there was just a scene where everyone was mad at Seabook for taking the Gundam. Seabook refuses, piloting the F91 to defend the ship. As he launches, he sees an enemy mobile suit being escorted to the space arc by Federation troops. He scouts the surrounding area and then returns to the space arc only to launch again in a few minutes when they come under attack. But because of the pacing, it's implied that more time has passed, with the crew meeting the character Anne-Marie, a defecting CV pilot that brings them a disc full of combat data. Anne-Marie is one of the more confusing elements in the film, and probably something that should have been cut out of the final draft. She's only been a background character for a few scenes, and then she sort of gets mad that Zabine is spending time with Cecily, and then she defects because she's so pissed that the Ronas are getting, like, special treatment. And then she repaints her MS and joins the fray, only to be killed by Zabine almost immediately. And from start to finish, this arc with Anne-Marie lasted almost 10 minutes. As a result of this battle, Cecily actually returns with Seabook to the space arc, explaining that she didn't know they were all still alive and never wanted to go with the Crossbone Vanguard anyway. Which is confusing, because she had the opportunity to leave with Seabook earlier, but didn't. Anyway, people don't really trust her, but she does her best to fit in with the crew and as a pilot. Up until this point in F91, there have been rumblings of Carrazzo having some sort of sinister plan apart from the overall goal of Cosmo Babylon. Zabine even mentions earlier that he doesn't know where Carrazzo's loyalties lie. We see him hail a ship under Carrazzo's personal command, and they deny him the ability to resupply, giving more stock to the fact that Iron Mask has his own plans. We keep hearing mentions of something called bugs that will help secure the colonies for the Crossbone Vanguard, and it isn't something that sounds particularly cheery either. Seabook's mom shows up at the space arc finally, but gets a lukewarm reaction from her own children, as they aren't very happy with the fact that she left her family to work on a war machine. She said that she developed the biocomputer to help humanity, but then she did stick it in a giant robot with a laser gun, so... Fighting in Frontier 1 begins again in the mobile suit pilots aboard the Space Arc sortie, including Cecily in her repainted mobile suit. Inside the colony, we're treated to the horrors of what the bugs actually are. Car-sized, top-shaped drones equipped with saw blades and laser guns that fly around and only target humans. Carrazzo releases the bugs into the colony as a test run. If they're successful, he wants to release them on both the moon and Earth in a bid to kill 9/10 of humanity in order to set up his new kingdom. It seems like Carrazzo is pretty much alone in his plan, well, him and those under him that could create thousands of drones. I gotta say, I found this twist to be super silly. I thought maybe the bugs would be like nanomachines or small bug-sized drones that would hunt down people and kill them. But what we ended up with was much less subtle. Seabook even figures out the best way to fight the bugs is to just spin his beam sabers around really fast while flying, something I'm surprised other mobile suits don't do more often. I'll take a second to just mention the music for F91. I said earlier this movie takes a lot of inspiration from Star Wars, and this definitely shines through in the music. I'd go so far as to say that some of these songs might actually just be plagiarism. I mean, there's just no way you can listen to this track and not hear the Imperial March. Cecily makes her way to the Crossbone Vanguard fleet without being detected, since her mobile suit is still broadcasting a friendly ID tag to them, and she does something that's actually incredibly smart. She uses the wreckage of mobile suits around the battlefield to blow up the ship commanding the bugs. It's actually a really interesting way to do it. This causes the climax of the movie to be Seabook facing Carrazzo personally as he pilots a weird-looking mobile armor. Also, surprise, because Carrazzo is apparently a cyber new type, which is revealed in an offhand line by Cecily. His appearance in the final battle is really cool, however, as he has all these wires running out of his head and his cockpit is like this glass dome. It's really cool, which is more than I can say for his mobile armor, since it sort of looks like a big pomegranate. The biocomputer within the F91, combined with Seabook's latent new type abilities, allows the F91 to basically go Super Saiyan. It flies around at super high speeds and starts leaving after images that confuse Carrazzo's targeting systems. It's definitely pretty out there, but when Gundam starts getting into new type stuff, it does tend to get a little weird. Carrazzo rips his own daughter out of her cockpit with his bare hands and he just like doesn't give a shit about being shot. He then just hucks her out into space. It's pretty cold-blooded. Seabook is able to use the wreckage of Cecily's mobile suit to distract Carrazzo with an explosion and takes him out once and for all. With the help of his mother and the biocomputer guiding his newly awakened new type abilities, Seabook is able to sense where Cecily is floating through space and recover her. We end the movie with the two sharing an embrace in the void of space as the credits roll and we learn that F91 would be just the beginning of a new Gundam saga. And while those continuations never really came to fruition outside of the Crossbone Gundam manga, I think that there's still value to be had with this movie. Mobile Suit Gundam F91 is a lot of things. It's poorly paced, confusing, and rushed at times. But it also has some of the best animation the series has seen so far, and really, really well-designed mech suits. At times, F91 almost feels like the Gundam franchise boiled down to its essence and then, like, crushed into one of those scrapyard metal car cubes. We get all the familiar character beats of a full-fledged Gundam show, but they really only work if you're a viewer with a good amount of history with the series. If I'd watched this without watching everything that had come before it, I think I would have been lost, and at least an hour of the film's runtime would have been spent on the Gundam Wiki instead of watching the F91 kick ass. While I wouldn't say that the characters presented are amazing, the designs certainly are well thought out. Zabeen in particular is a pretty memorable look, what with his very pirate-like eye patch. Seabook, on the other hand, is very vanilla. I feel like he's sort of every protagonist mashed together and aged up a few years. He does have blue hair though, which gives him extra points because we gotta love anime characters with blue hair. Cecily is a pretty cool design with her striking red hair and elegant clothing. I do enjoy watching her and Seabook interacting together, and even though it's basically just the bones of the relationship that would have been depicted in a full show, it's nice to see them together at the end. All in all, I am glad I gave F91 a watch because it was an interesting experience. Knowing the history behind the movie before going in makes it pretty fun. You can definitely point out the different plot points and sort of pick out where they would have been in a full series. Luckily, F91 is really easy to find as the Blu-ray version is widely available. The movie is also fully dubbed, and the dub is actually pretty competent, though I prefer the subtitled version personally. And there we have it. F91 is a weird piece of Gundam history that never really got its concepts off the ground. Luckily for fans, the next OVA series would begin airing only a few months after F91 premiered. Next time, we'll talk about Mobile Suit Gundam 0083 Stardust Memory. See you then! Hey everyone, how's it going? Welcome to the end card. If you can hear shit happening in the background, I apologize. My neighbor's dog is like freaking out. Hardcore. Thank you so much for watching this video, and thank you for watching all the way to the end card. If you're hearing this, that's pretty fucking sweet. Next week is going to be a non-Gundam video. We're going to have an anime retrospective coming out that I think people will actually really enjoy. And then after that, we'll be getting into Stardust Memory, which I'm already watching and I have a lot of opinions about. And then I'm not too sure. I'm not sure if I'm going to have Victory ready to go right after Stardust, just because it's a 50-episode series, so there might be another anime thing or a game thing after Stardust. But I'll try and keep people informed either way, so that no one's in the dark about what's coming out and when. Anyway, guys. Oh, also, one more thing, because these are unscripted and I like to babble. I've been thinking about streaming again. I used to stream quite a bit, but I kind of want to stream a little bit more. So you can find my Twitch in the description if you go down to it and you want to see live gameplay where I might talk about Gundam and other stuff as well, and interact with chat, talking about anime and games and stuff like that. Go ahead and give that a follow. I don't know when I'm going to start streaming, but I would like to hop back into that world, especially now that I have a schedule going for these videos where, like, I feel pretty comfortable having a video out every week and not having the workload be, like, crushing. So, yeah, if that's something you're interested in, go ahead and follow that down in the description. And I've been talking way too long for the end card, so, again, thank you for watching. I hope you all enjoyed. And we will see you next week. Bye-bye now.